Hello everybody and welcome back to the Moshik's mainframe channel. This is Moshik's. Today we're going to have a very technical session, and I know that some of you like that very much, and I like it very much, so why don't we going to have some fun with that. As you know, I have three mainframes in the cloud. I have a MVS 3.8 in the cloud, and then I have also a VM 380 in the cloud, as you can see here. VM 370 in the cloud, and under this VM 370, I have in the past shown some videos on how to run the TK4 that we have running on top of Hercules directly. We can also have it running under VM 370. There are some advantages to running full operating systems under VM 370. One of them is that you only need to expose one internet port, so everybody connects to the same port of the same IP address, and then from there they can dial into whatever operating system they want or need. The other advantage is that you only have to back up one directory with Hercules and then with all your operating systems if you organize yourself well. The other advantage is that you can use, for certain operating systems which don't have built-in interactive capabilities such as DOS VS or even OS VS 1, which I've shown here in this channel in the past, you can use the excellent editing facilities and interactive facilities of VM 370 to edit your stuff, then submit jobs to those operating systems which do not have those interactive capabilities and get the results back into VM 370. So in a way, it's almost like you use the VM 370 as the interactive environment, and then you only use the batch environments of those those operating systems underneath it. Also, VM 370 is an excellent time sharing system, so you can exist on the same machine with many other users, and it's generally, I think personally, a more pleasant environment to work in. You have games, you have chatting capabilities, you just work with files. You don't have to work with complex partition data sets or data sets on the disk. There's no cataloging and all that kind of stuff. So it's just a simpler environment, especially for beginners. But it's also a very interesting environment because of its virtualization and capabilities, and because it's a hypervisor as well. However, and this is why we're making this video today, is that of all the operating systems which we can run under VM 370, TK4 as delivered with the MVS 3.8 as delivered by the TK4 distribution is actually the classically the worst performing citizen in a VM 370 environment. And today we're going to explore why, and we're also going to see some amazing patches produced by a very, very capable, I would say almost genius gentleman. And that's what we're going to do today. Let's get to it. So what's the problem, you may ask? Well, the TK4 distribution with the MVS 3.8 inside has a JES2, which has a very peculiar behavior. It doesn't close the output to the JES2 spooling data set on disk when it's finished processing a job. And what this means for VM 370 is, as long as it keeps the spool out open, almost like as if you imagine in a C program keeping the file open, as long as the file is kept open, VM 370 is not able to get the processed job output from that job back into VM 370. And that is the problem that exists with the normal distribution of TK4. The other problem that we have is that if you dial into the classic way that you get that into a guest operating system would be that you connect first to TK4 and then you would dial into VM 370 and then you will dial into TK4. Now once you dialed into TK4, you get a monitor like this, and of course you can log in and all that kind of stuff. But when you finished, how do you undial the terminal? Meaning that how do you release that terminal from MVS running under VM 370 and give that terminal control back to VM 370? So that capability is not in neither in MVS, neither and not also in VM370. So once the terminal is dialed into MVS under VM370, VM370 will not gonna get that terminal back. And if you disconnect and reconnect again to that same line, it will be still be under the control of MVS. So that makes it very hard to run MVS well under VM370, because sooner or later you'll run out of terminal lines that you can connect to VM370 for, because they will all be taken by MVS. So that was the problem, and that's why I didn't run. I've made some videos, of course, where I show how I take my MVS 3.8, the exact one that I run directly on Hercules, this one here, and then I've shown how to make it run under VM370. But I've never run it as a production environment under VM370 for those two reasons I just outlined. I'll repeat them again. One is that you cannot send jobs from VM370 to TK4 to MVS and get the job output back, because JES2 doesn't close the spool. And the second problem is that terminals that are dialed into MVS under VM370 are never released again. So that made it almost impossible to run it into production. However, one gentleman, Mr. Bob Polmunter, I hope I'm spelling his name right. I mean, I know I'm writing it right, but I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right. Yeah, this gentleman here, Wobbly, Bob Polmunter on GitHub, I've had hundreds of emails with him. He's a genius developer. He's done some very, very advanced stuff, of some of which I can't even talk here about, but he's really something special. And he produced a patch that will fix these two problems. So today I'm gonna show how to apply this patch to an MVS 3.8, so that afterwards we can IPL this MVS 3.8 under VM370 and have it become a good behaving citizen under VM370, just like all other operating systems. So that's what we're gonna do. And then maybe as a bonus in the end, we're gonna have this MVS 3.8, which is running naked on the Hercules emulator, compared with MVS 3.8 running under VM370, and we'll see what is the overhead of running under VM370. So let's put this aside for now, and let's just focus on this one. Okay, so what I do here is, first of all, let's get an MVS 3.8, and then we will run it under my VM370 distribution, just to show you the problem. So I have here a TK4 update 8, which is the latest update we have. Update 9 is still in the making for, I think, 3 years now. But I know that Jürgen, the maintainer of the TK4 distribution, is working on update 9. And if we're lucky, we may see it in the next 6 months, maybe by early 2020, mid 2020. So first of all, let's unzip TK4. Okay, so that's done. And I always go to unattended first and set it into console mode. Okay, so that is done. And now we'll have to just start it. I think we can close this for now, and let's work with my local system. Okay, so I'm connected now to this machine here, where Hercules is running with MVS on top of it. And then we have now, if I log in, see you later is the password. I'm now, as you can see here, I just connected here now. So what we have to do is obviously run a job that we were, so the patches to both enable disconnection of the terminal from MVS as well as basically from VTAM, and also to close the JES two outputs every time a job is finished is contained in a tape image, which I have here. Bob sent it to me, and that will link in the description below the video to where you can get this patch. So the patch is here. Where is it? This one, MVS VM. So what we have to do is we'll have to load this this patch into MVS by reading in this tape. It's an AWS tape format, so what we'll have to do is load it into the tape drive, dev init 480, and then it's called MVS VM. Okay, so now we loaded this tape into the tape drive. How do we get read this now into MVS 3.8? Well, that's how we do it. Let's make this a little bit bigger so we can all see. Okay, so we put this in R01 CNTL. Okay, so this is the JCL that we'll read in from the tape, unit 480. As you just saw, we mounted the tape on unit 480 here and move it from this data set in there with the series number, with the serial number MVS VM1 into HERC MVS VM JCL. So we put it all in there, and this should execute just fine. Let's see what happens. Keep an eye on here. Yes, so this seems to have gone well. Yeah, return code 0. Everything was read in. So we should see it now if you go to 3.4 or 01. Yes, here it is. Perfect. So everything we need here, this is one to let VTEM release the terminal back to VM370, and this seems to be the one for JES2. Yes, CP close on JES2 print punch. Fantastic. So why don't we, before we execute this, I would like to show you folks what the problem is with the behavior of TK4 directly under VM370. And for that, we're going to stop here. We're going to stop this MVS and run it, IPL it under VM370. So let's disconnect this one. And this is going to go down pretty soon. What I want to do is shut it down so I can copy all the disks of this MVS under VM370. And then we IPL VM370. And then under VM370, we IPL this MVS that we just saw here. And to prove it, I'll show you that we have the same data set that we looked at also there. And I'll show you what the problem is with submitting jobs into it. Then we're gonna shut VM370 down and IPL just the MVS part again, patch it, copy it over to under VM370 again, and start again VM370, and now everything should work. So that's the plan. In broad strokes, just first show you the problem, then shut it down, patch MVS, IPL it again under VM370, and then Bob should be your uncle. No pun intended. Okay, so JES2 is done, looks here. Okay. Okay. So this has finished. Now we can quiesce it, and we can stop all. Wait, Very good. So I happen to have here a six pack, which is the VM370 distribution. Okay. And in there I have several guests. And we have some videos about it. I have an MVT distribution there. I have a DOS-VS distribution. I also happen to have one with OS-VS1. And then we also have MVS. And in here, we're going to copy all the DASTI files of the MVS, virgin MVS, with the data set uploaded, with the patches uploaded, but not applied yet in here. So we'll do it like this. Root, Bob, DASTI. Everything into here. That was fast. So now the only thing we need to do is IPL this VM370. Okay. And we just do Hercules minus F Hercules, which is the minus F Hercules is not required if the name of the configuration file is Hercules.cnf, but I'm just used to do it this way. Okay, so VM is already up. VM370 IPLs much faster than MVS, and a further advantage of running everything under MVS, under VM370. So enable all, start all. Okay, as you can see here, it's up and running. So let's connect to it. Okay, we're connected. Let's make this a little bit larger. And let's go first check the directory entry. Well, we actually don't need to check the directory entry, I know it. So we do ltk4. Okay, so now what we can do is set breakpoint. Yeah, that was not supported yet. There is a way, term break key, in newer versions of VM to set the break key. For instance, I set it often to PF12 so that I can just press PF12 and I go from guest back to the CP and then I can disconnect. But we don't have this in this old version of VM370. So why don't we just do an IPL 148. And we can see here, that, yeah, so MVS is already saying specify system release for 3.8. So we say command equals 03, which is the way to start it without all the stuff that's in TK4, such as the 3705 emulator and all the other stuff. We just do the bare minimum. And here, I think we have to say hard copy. Let me check what we have to say. Well, actually started IPLing on its own. Yeah, so it seems everything is up. So if we now log on, yes. If we say new session, now we can show what the problem is. First of all, let's make sure dial PK4. So see you later, it's the password. As you can see here, this is working furiously, 150 MIPS. Okay, so let's see if we still see the data set we just pulled in from tape. Yes, it's still there. This is the VM exit to get the terminal back from VM370. And here it's defined as the command VM. Maybe we can try the command undial. Yeah, we could easily change that because that's a standard modern command for undialing, is undial. But I don't know if the length needs to be, let's see, the log, so VM. Let's see if we can change it to undial without breaking the application. It is checking. Yeah, it's maximum 5 characters. So I guess we could change it here to undial, but we just know it's, you know, for all intents and purposes, it's VM. So that's fine. Anyway, so that's what we have now running here. Now to show you the problem, I can do now one more terminal and I'll log in into VM370. And let's say, do I have, yeah, so I have a job here, IFBR14JCLA, which is just this little job here, which does, it's a job that does nothing. We can fix it a little bit by saying sysprint dd, the uppercase, and then we would have to say here message class A. So we would get, normally with this job we would get the full output, right? So let's copy this and why is this okay. So if we copy this and run it here locally, so we are now here in MVS in VM370, right? If I create a new job here, IFBR14, then, well, there is no A, would usually go directly to the printer, but we're since running on the VM370, let's do it like this and let's run it to see if this would execute fine. Okay, so start 3.8. Yeah, here we see it executed fine. Job it now. How do we could also now try to get this job to run from within VM370 under, to get VM370 to punch it to TK4 running under VM370, let MVS process the job and get the output back. But as we can see, we'll see in a second, this is not going to work. So spool punch to TK4. Now we say punch IFBR14JCLA, no error. So as you can see here, it just executed, right? We'll also see it here. This did execute. However, we did not get back any feedback. And you can see here on the console that it is running. So let's try this again. Keep an eye on three things. The CPU here, oops. All right, we'll keep an eye on this MIPS indicator here and on the console of MVS 3.8 running under VM370. So if I do the same thing again, you should see now here a new job appearing, job number 4, and you should see the MIPS indicator go up each time. All right, let's do that. As you can see, this just ran with return code 0. We know it runs fine, and we saw the MIPS going up. We can do this at will. So now this time, keep an eye on the indicator here, and we'll not process it. And if I do it again, it will run here. Now what I don't get is the job output back, and that's because JAS2 in this MVS here is not closing, basically is not closing the file. In C language it means not closing the file, and as long as the file is open we cannot get it back. And the other thing that I want to show is we have here this, where is the interactive session? So we want to get out of here. I do log off, and there's no way to get the terminal back to VM370. It stays connected always to MVS, and VM will never get this job back. So what we're going to do is now patch the MVS this MVS right now is running under VM370. We're going to IPL it on Hercules directly, and or we can actually even do it here. There's no reason to have to do it. Yeah, we can save one IPL if we do it all under VM370, then shut it down and then IPL it again. So why don't we do this? Let's go here. For now, I think we don't need this job anymore. This session with VM370. So see, here it goes back to VM370, but this will never go back to VM370. So let's put this here for a second and let's run those patches. See, there is the password per default. 160 MIPS I was seeing here. And of course it sees us as logging in, that's fine. And let's go 3.4. And here is the two patches. So let's do this one first. I think it's easier. Let's fix this job a little bit. Message class H. So we can see if it went through fine. And then it's just patching and recompiling JS2. So this job will recompile JS2, and the way in TK4 to recompile JS2 or to reassemble it is to go through the SMP method. You shouldn't really do it directly, you should always go through SMP. So it applies the patch and then recompiles it, or basically links it again. So let's save it and keep an eye on the indicator for MIPS here. And you should see the job here with Z, ERG01Z. Let's see how this goes. Okay, 150 MIPS, and it's already done. Oh, there's some problems. What's the problem? This didn't... I don't think this went well. Yeah, this wants to run. Yeah, we don't have all the... Yeah, we don't have all the disks defined under VM370. So I guess we have to do this. Receive. So this is still stuck in SMP, so we have to cancel it. You have to shut this down. Yeah. We have to do this directly because we don't have all the DASTIs defined on the VM370. I didn't think I would need the SMP DASTIs, but I do. This doesn't really matter. Okay, so we'll have to do this actually directly on top of Hercules. We cannot patch it on the VM370. That only takes us about a second. So, okay, let's. Okay, yes. Then now we can do cancel JRP, cancel MF1, we cancel SNASL. Cancel 001Z and we cancel VSP pilot, cancel SIMD1, we turn off networking and then we cancel. We shut down JS2, but it won't go down because we still have a job waiting for some DASTIs. So we do PJS2 append. We basically kill JS2. We purge the output. and we shut down SMF, and now we do a quiesce. Okay, now, oh, wait a minute. Now we shut VM370 down here. We say drain all, shut down. Okay. So that's it. So now we go back to Bob, and we start this MVS, the exact same one over here, without VM370. I hope you can follow everything we're doing here. I know it's a little fast, but a lot of people will be able to follow. And now we just have to wait until this comes up. Yeah, Gesto is already up. Yes. Okay. So let's try to apply the patch again. Let's start with the Gesto patch. We'll have to fix this again, because remember we had copied the files over, so we still have the original state before we copied to VM370. And I want to give it H and message level. Okay. So this should now execute fine. SMP receive. Okay, let's keep an eye on the MIPS indicator and let's just run it. So it's assembling here, relinking Gesto. This time it seems to run fine. Apply, right? And it's done. Let's look at, yeah, return code 0. So we have now fixed Gesto, so we will close the output each time a job is finished. That's fine. And now we go apply the other exit. H message level. I'm not sure that this will work because I don't have ERK01 MacLib. So Bob probably had his own micro libraries, which he would put in the concatenation first. But I think we don't need this. I think we should run it like that. Let's see the rest of the job. Yeah, it's patching VTEM. And it's creating a new login procedure, so we have to copy this procedure over. And then there's one more change we need to do in Gesto, which I forgot to do. But for now, let's just run this. Job submitted. Okay, so this went well. Now we have to do some configuration file changes after we apply the patches. Let's start with Gesto. Sys1, Gesto. Yeah. So here we have to apply VM. That's for class A, and we also do it here, and we also do it here. This way now it knows that for this printer, if you don't put VM, it will still behave the same, but if you put VM, it will close the spool each time it finishes a job. I also don't think it makes any sense to have the separator in the output, because it will not look good under VM370. So let's put in no sep. Okay. So now we have no separator, and we should also have the punch. Yeah, we'll also say VM. And this is already with no separator, of course. There is a manual here somewhere. Can't find it. But I think this is how we should do it. So no separator for class A printer. Class Z can keep its separator. VM. Of course, we always have to be very careful when we modify the Jest 2 parameters, because you may not be able to start Jest 2 otherwise. But that's why we have some backup. So we can, if this doesn't IPL, then we can, or start Jest 2, we can use the other ones. Okay, the other thing that we have to do is change the login procedure, right? So we do it here. And what was the name of the login procedure? ETH. Okay, here it is. So let's change it here everywhere. So now it uses a different procedure, and that procedure knows about disconnecting from VTEM. So that's basically what's going on. Very, very smart patch. What Bob did here is amazing. An amazing programmer. And I think we have to delete the object file so that VTEM will regenerate it. I think, hopefully, did the right thing. If I could only find the manual. Where was it? Yeah. Ah, here it is. Okay, so yeah, so we have to, yeah, perfect. So we did that right. Yes, and we did that right as well. No sep VM. Fantastic. Okay, so it looks like we did everything right. Now we just have to shut it down. Wait for it to come down. And then we have to restart Jest 2 with cold for this to take effect. But first I want to be sure that system IPLs again. Okay. JRP. Waiting for VTEM to shut down, especially because we just patched it. I don't want to mess things up. I know this is a very technical video, folks, but that's the way I like it. That's the kind of the things I do to relax on weekends. It's 6:40 a.m. on a Sunday. What's happening here? Okay, so now, yeah, Jest 2 doesn't want to shut down. We just do an append. We'll have to cold format anyway. And now, okay. And now we don't even have to, well, the 148. We'll start it again. Oops. Okay. Reconnect. We have to start it now without automation because I need to reformat JES too. Okay. Format. Yes. It's formatting the JES2 datasets, you can see here. This actually takes a little while. Doing a lot of I/O. Okay. So if formatted. Okay, so that's now. And now we start it normally again, because we just formatted. Okay, let's see how this goes this time. Yeah, JES2 came up, no problems with the parameters. The only thing I still want to check is if VTEM restarts. If it does, then we can shut down and copy everything under VM370. And then we should be able to punch jobs into it and get responses back from MVS into my VM370 session. So I hope you can all follow. Yep, this seems to work. Not. Yeah, so there seems to be a problem here. Why is my VTEM not working? You can see here, yeah, my VTEM session is stopped. Oh, I know why. We need to reformat the link pack area. Okay, so FVSP pilot shut fast. Okay. Yeah, I should have done a CLPA, which means reformat the link pack area, which the link pack area is almost like a cache for very often used modules of the operating system. And since we changed VTEM, we need to reformat it in the sense that it needs to recompile and put the new modules back into the cache area, into the link pack area. So let's help MVS to go down. JRP. I make this mistake, so you don't have to make them, and we all learn something from my mistakes. So that's why these videos can sometimes be useful. Stop TSO. Yeah. And now we cancel everything. Okay. The only thing running is now JES2. Perfect. It will probably not want to go down without a fight. Yes. So now we do a bend, that's okay. End of day, bias. Oops, Okay, so now we IPL 148 again. And no, that's not what I wanted. This automation is really sometimes in the way of things. You have to start it again like this and do the reformatting of the link pack area. So how do we do that? We do an IPL 148. We don't need no terminals for that. And now here MVS says specify system parameters. So what we say here in this case is reply with CLPA, cold link pack area. So it will now, yes, it has now reformatted the link pack area. And now we can just shut down again. Okay. And now we reconnect, and maybe this time VTEM will have the new login procedure in the link pack area. A link pack area is a memory in the low end of the address space that contains cached modules, basically part of the operating system that is very often needed. You can decide what goes in there. There's a parameter in sys1 parmlib that determines what goes in there, and you can make things much faster if you have files, parts of the operating system that are used very, very often. If you put them there, then they being executed from memory. So it's almost like the link pack area is almost like it's a memory disk. It's a disk in memory from which the operating system will read when it needs certain modules. Okay, so this works now. As we can see, I can log in and I can log out. So we were right. We can disconnect this terminal and shut down again. Okay, JRP, DP, Stasol, okay, cancel DSP pilot, cancel CMD1, do that quick. Okay, so we finished patching successfully. And now we just have to copy all the files into root, sixpack, MVS, guests, MVS, pasty, into here. So now we have the patched version of VM of MVS 3.8. We put it into the directory of files for those disks under sixpack, under MVS, under VM 370. Can I speak today? And now we're going to go to sixpack VM and start it here. Okay, VM 370 is up. Start all. Yes. So now we should be able to connect this terminal. No, we can't because we have to change the port number. Okay. We can close all other terminals for now, because everything else we're going to do from here now. And this one as well. Alrighty, things are now a little bit clearer. What we've done is we patched MVS 3.8 so that it can close the spool and it will release terminals again back to VM 370. So what we're going to do now is first of all dial into TK4, log on into TK4. Okay, so we logged on and we say now IPL 148. No special parameters needed, and now it's IPLing VM 370. We, in the meantime, will launch a different terminal. Yes, Jess2 is alive. It's still processing stuff. It's not finished yet. Yes. Okay. So TKS is initialized now. TSO will come up. So TSO is now up. We don't need TSO because we're going to do now, however, everything from VM 370. Let me log on here to main. Okay. Now let's see if we can get anything to run here and produce the output back here. So that's the first test we're going to do. So we say spool punch user TK4, which is this operating system here, and now we say punch IFBR 14JCL. Well, let's look at it first. IFBR 14JCLA. So you can see that's the job that we're going to send here. Okay, so let's send this job and let's see if we can get the output from this job back into my VM 370 user here called maint, just a super user, but any user will work. Oh, actually I spotted one tiny error. We should terminate Jess2 like that always. You don't have to, but it's good practice. Okay, so spool or punch IFBR 14JCLA, no header. Let's see if we see it appearing here. And if you get any, yeah, so we punched job HERC01, it processed 32 lines and we got the file back. So we now see Q query printer all. We see that we have this file 703. I can purge print all and now. Yeah, these are owned by TK4, but so now we don't have any. We have to punch our job again. Punch IFBR. Punch IFBR 14JCL. No header. And now we got this output back here from here. So let's read it. Read card IFBR 14 listing A. So it's long 132 bytes because the printer 1403 is 132 characters long, the printer itself. So let's go see what the output is. We can just do type IFBR 14 listing A. And here is the output without the header, the usual MVS header, because we said we put it in the Jess2 parameters that we don't want a header for the for printer A. If I put it on printer class B, I think, then we would get the header because there we kept the header on. So this all works fine and no separated pages, which makes the reading much easier. So now we could really do anything that we can do from TSO, we can do from here. In terms of submitting jobs and looking at output. And we don't have to start any consoles here. So that's one thing that worked. Okay, that works fine. Now the other thing is see if we can get any terminals back from MVS back to VM37. So for that, what we do is, we don't need this anymore right now. What we do is we say dial TK4. So by dialing, we give this terminal now to the control of anything that deals with this lines, terminal lines under the operating system under VM370. So it says dial to TK4 as address 0C0. So now I can log in, see you later. And you can see on the console of VM370 of MVS 3.8 is telling us that it just noticed us logging in. So we're now in. We can do anything we want. Everything runs fine. Now, the only problem is, how do we get back from here? As you noticed before at the beginning of this video, we couldn't release the terminal from MVS 3.8. We couldn't give it back to VM370. So let's see if we can do it now. So you saw that VM was the word or the code word to give to the logger procedure to release this terminal from its control and therefore give it back to VM37. Let's see if this works. I type in VM and yes. So now we have both working properly, and that's the way we want to have it. And now that we have an MVS 3.8 that is a good citizen under VM370, we can now run all our operating systems under VM370. Yes, it's true, if VM370 dies, all its operating systems running underneath it will die too. But VM370 is extremely stable. I would say maybe even more stable than MVS 3.8, certainly on Hercules. So I'm not really worried about that. And that's how I'm now running my mainframes in the cloud. My MVS, the official MVS, is now the one running under VM370. And that's the only one I will back up. I will not back up the MVS 3.8 running in parallel on the same machine, but on top of Hercules directly, because there's no need anymore, right? For me, it's much easier. I back up everything from one directory, which contains all the guests, as you saw before, and now works perfectly. And that's how I roll. So what we did in this video is we saw that the normal MVS 3.8 doesn't close the spool, so you cannot send jobs from VM370 or from any other operating systems to MVS and get the output back. And also VTEM EMVS 3.8 does not release terminals when you're done with them, does not allow you to get control of those terminals back to VM370. We found an amazing patch by Bob Polmenter, whom I'm thanking here, and I've had some wonderful email exchanges with him. So thank you, Bob. I'm really impressed by all the work that you do, and some of which I cannot talk about here, but he's really doing magic with his stuff. And then we patched our MVS 3.8 and saw that we need to make some small configuration changes to the JES2 parameters, as well as to the logon procedure definition in VTEM. Then we saw that we need to cold format the JES2 spool, and actually in the instructions it says it's not required, but it is required, otherwise it will not pick up the change in separator page configuration, Bob, if you're listening. And the other thing is we needed to do a cold format of the link pack area so that the new modules for VTEM would be picked up. And so we fixed that and we moved it over under VM370. We IPL'd VM370. We started TK4 here and we tested, we punched some jobs into it. We got the reply back and then we logged on to TSO and released the terminal back to VM370. So everything is working, and that's the nice thing about mainframing, when things just work and as they should, very predictable, very reliable, and we're having a lot of fun. So it's a longer video, very, very technical. I'm going at a fast pace because otherwise it would have been even longer. But if you have any questions about what we did, just write the questions in below this video. If you have any comments, any other opinions, please post them in the comments below this video. I will also post below this video where you can find the patches from Bob Polmenter, including the instructions from my GitHub repository. And I hope to see you soon on other Moshix videos. If you like this particular video, do press on the thumbs up button. Always motivates me. I always like when people engage with me by pressing on the thumbs up button and, of course, by subscribing. Thank you for watching and goodbye.